Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
Joshua 7:19, and Joshua said unto Achan, My son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. And Achan answered Joshua and said, Indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoils a goodly Babylonish garment, and 200 shekels of silver, and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran into the tent, and behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. It says there in verse 21, if we look at what Achan confessed to, he said that the things that he saw, and that's where it all begins. He said, then I coveted them and took them. Notice how that process goes. He said, he just owned right up to it. He said, I took it. I'll preach a message on that thought this morning. I took it. In Mark 7, verse 21 to 23, the Bible said, For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornication, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man. Notice, covetousness is in there. In Luke chapter 12 and verse 15, he said unto them, Take heed, Jesus speaking here, he said, and beware of covetousness. He said, For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth. Paul writing, I just want to give you several verses here to get whet your appetite. In Romans 7:7, he said, What shall we say to these things? He said, Is the law sin? God forbid. He said, Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. For I had not known lust, except the law said, Thou shalt not covet. We spend a lot of time stressing that salvation is by grace through faith, plus nothing, minus nothing. That we're not under the law. But is the law still applicable? Some would argue, no, it's not. But the law, as it has always been intended, was never to be a means of salvation for anybody. You know, all these people say, well, I keep the Ten Commandments. Well, no, you don't. But what was the purpose of it? We find out in the book of Galatians. Paul said that it was a schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. In other words, it shows us how guilty we are. And then when we say, well, I can't do that. Right. So what's our fix? Turn to Christ. And so the law is still applicable in that sense. It is the moral law is still applicable. But you'd never know it today. You'd never know it today. And I'll get into that in just a bit. James said in James 1 and verse 14 and 15, he said, But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death. Notice the process of it. It begins with a covetousness, a lusting, and then you do the deed. I took it. In 2 Timothy 3, in verse 1 and 2, some verses that you probably should have memorized just so you'll know who you're dealing with. And by the way, it's not talking about the lost world here. Oh, it is. But it's talking about just in general, all of us. It says, this know also that in the last days, perilous times shall come. We're in the last days. Perilous times have come. He said, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. He didn't say lost people will be lovers of their own selves. Doesn't even say, he just, as a blanket statement, said men, mankind, will be madly in love with themselves. That's the number one thing. So it doesn't surprise me when we see that. But notice it goes on. It says, men shall be lovers of their own selves. The very next statement is covetous. Covetous. We want what somebody else has. We're not content with what we have. Man's covetousness of the belongings of others is so rampant in the last days that stealing is done openly in broad daylight. And we've become so out of touch with it that people, for a variety of reasons, but because there's such an indifference, number one, but number two, because they're concerned or worried about the ramifications of doing anything, they just sit and watch it. Watch the news. You see it all the time. People stealing things and people just standing by watching them. They don't step in. People call it by several different terms, but it's still stealing, and it's wrong. Let me say that again. Stealing is wrong. Oh, I know, we're not under the law. You do realize that it's one of the Ten Commandments. But God is saying to us here that even though we're not under the law, the moral law does still exist, and we're supposed to adhere to it. It has a purpose in our lives. It's supposed to cause us to see how outright unrighteous we are and turn to the only fix that there is. However, as he states in 2 Timothy chapter 3, in the last days, the covetousness of man has risen up to number two. I don't know if they're specifically in order, but God did give them in order. And so I'm going to go on the thought that perhaps they are by the most prevalent. So number one, people will be madly in love with themselves. I think we see that a lot. You ever see people with their phones? And I don't know why. Maybe they want to see what God sees. Because they always have the phone up here, you know? Crazy. And if they're not madly in love with themselves, which is number one, then the next thing on the list is covetous. And we know that when covetous behavior is exhibited, then we will automatically follow through with some lust. And when lust, when it's finished, you'll just do it. Look at Achan. He said, I saw that stuff there. He said, I couldn't help myself. I saw it. I took it. Now, he paid the consequences for it. Of course, if he was living in 2024, they probably would have just said, well, don't do that again. Send him home. And he'd probably get to keep. But I looked up all the words that are used, because that's what we do, you know. We don't like certain, people don't want to be called a thief or a crook. So they come up with these words. How about, look at all of this list. Rather than steal. I don't steal. I take, I snatch, I loot, I swipe, I lift, I pinch, I boost, I rip off, I make off with, I appropriate, I misappropriate, I pilfer, I rob, I burglarize, I seize, I prolong, I hijack, I carjack, I commandeer. And the one that really has taken on a new twist is shoplifting. Shoplifting. Shoplifting is defined as entering into a commercial establishment with an intent to commit larceny while it's open during regular business hours and the value of the property taken is less than $950. Shoplifting has become so lucrative that the criminal enterprise system is taking over the operation around the country. It's called ORC, Organized Retail Crime. They're actually hiring people to go out and do this. It's so lucrative. And because there's no one doing anything about it. It's just one of those petty things. Well, God thought that stealing, no matter what your reasoning is, God thought it was pretty bad. He made it as one of the 10 things he said, man ought not to do that. ORC is large-scale theft on an organized criminal scale, and it's become a business. Retail stores are closing because of it. Consumers, all of us, are paying the price because of it, because of the loss associated with it. Retail theft losses swelled to $112 billion in 2022, up 19% from $93.9 billion the year before. Last days. You know, God said, again, one of those things that he says more than once, he said, thou shalt not steal, in Exodus 20:15 and Deuteronomy 5 and verse 19. And the word to steal in the Bible means to cheat or to deprive another party of that which is rightfully theirs, to take what belongs to another without their consent. How many here this morning have ever had something stolen from you? Bunch of liars. How many here have ever... If I wouldn't get a positive answer out of this, I'm definitely not going to get one out of this. How many of you have ever taken something that didn't belong to you? Well, I guess you're more criminal than victim, I guess. You know, the Bible doesn't have a problem with man having stuff as long as it's acquired the right way. And God has a method by which he said that we're to set our affection on things above, not on things on the earth. And I want to look at several things here that God says we could do in order to not fall into the trap of becoming covetous and lusting and ultimately stealing. Because we're going to see by the time I'm done here that stealing is, well, it's one of those sorts of things that sometimes I don't think we actually understand completely the full extent of what thievery is. Whenever we talk about a thief or something like that, we say, well, I never robbed a bank. That's taking thievery to an extreme, right? Most thieves have never robbed a bank. They have more sense than that. Number one, let me say that God says, If you want to not fall into the trap of being covetous, become an Achan, where you see things and you just take them, starts with diligent labor. Diligent labor. Work. I remember when, it's a few years ago, when Mitt Romney, he was running for president, and did he run against Barack Obama? Yeah, he did. And of course, Barack Obama was giving out Obama phones and, you know, all that stuff. But not Mitt Romney. Mitt Romney, he had a real platform. He said, I'm going to get everybody a job. Yeah, how'd that go for him? I'm telling you, these last days, we're watching society as it has always been crumble. Psalm 128 and verse 2 says, "For thou shalt eat the labor of thine hands." In other words, you want to eat? Work. Proverbs 13 and verse 11 says, "Wealth gotten by vanity shall be diminished, but he that gathereth by labor shall increase." God has always blessed individuals who would work. And I've always been of the opinion that if you want to work, God will help you find a job. Amen. But there's plenty of people that don't want to work, and they use it as an excuse to not work. There's jobs if you want them. Ephesians 4 and verse 28 said, "Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor." So there is no justification, as far as God is concerned, for stealing. He said, if you've been stealing, he said, stop doing that. Get a job. Working with his own hands. Maybe that's the problem today. Maybe we don't work enough with our hands. We're all intellectuals. The thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. God's attitude. So let me see if I understand what God is saying here. I think what he's actually saying is the government ought not to be a goodwill agency that just gives away everybody else's money. I mean, that's really what a politician is, isn't it? Somebody that spends somebody else's money. Not a bad job if you can get it. Diligent labor. Number one, that's God's way. Shrewd investments. Look with me quickly in Matthew 25. See, God's not opposed to people having stuff. The have-nots in this world, they are. They find that anyone that has ever worked and succeeded and become successful monetarily, they're wicked and evil. No, they've done what they should do, and if they've succeeded in acquiring wealth, good for them. Hey, there's no bum standing on the street corner that ever gave anybody a job. You want me to say it again? Matthew 25, verse 14. The kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And he said unto one, he gave 5 talents, to another 2, another 1, to every man according to his several abilities, and straightway took his journey. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded with the same and made them other 5 talents. Imagine that. And likewise, he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth unto them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. He also that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I have gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of thy Lord. Then he which had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew thee, that thou art a hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid. So I went down to the welfare office And I was afraid and went and hid the talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. Here it is. And the Lord said, well, at least you didn't spend it foolishly. No, the Lord answered and said unto him, thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knowest that I reap where I sow not and gather where I have not strawed. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received mine own with usury. God expects that if we're not going to work with our hands and acquire, then he said, you know, why don't you just invest? Why don't you invest? Say, is there another one? Yeah. I think prayer, believing prayer, might work. In James 4 and verse 2, he said, you lust and have not, you kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you have not because you ask not. In Matthew 6 and verse 11, Jesus taught his disciples to pray. He said, they were to say, give us this day our daily bread. You can pray for it. Now, prayer is not a substitution for working or investing. There's nothing wrong with having property if it's obtained in a biblically acceptable fashion. However, there are ways that are not biblically acceptable. And boy, has mankind figured out those. Number one, through deprivation. Everybody knows the story of the Good Samaritan, right? In Luke chapter 10, verse 30, Jesus answered, he said, a certain man went down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell among thieves, which stripped him of his raiment and wounded him and departed, leaving him half dead. Stealing is a fashion, I guess it's becoming more blatant. It's still breaking the eighth commandment, but we would think that no one would be so brazen as to, you know, take from somebody that was down or somebody that was dead. But it goes on. It goes on. They'll whack somebody in the head, drop them like a sack, and then go through their pockets and take whatever they can. Deprivation. And Jesus tells the story about a character that fell among thieves and they stripped him of his raiment. And they wounded him and left him that way. That's the day we're living in, folks, where people have no concern for one another. You see it all the time. You don't have to follow the news too much to see how many times this kind of behavior goes on. They're walking into shops and making demands, taking what somebody else has worked hard for, and in the process, willing to kill you for it. The story is told of a shoplifter who writes to a department store and says, I've just become a Christian and I can't sleep at night because I feel guilty. So here's the $100 I owe you. Then he signed his name, and with this little postscript at the bottom, he adds, if I still can't sleep, I'll send you the rest. But there are more subtle ways of thievery today that have almost become socially acceptable. It's called permanently borrowing. Permanently borrowing. Some people borrow company supplies. I'll just get that at work. You know, paper, postage stamps, pens, nuts, bolts, whatever. Tools. How about hotel towels? How about a neighbor's shovel? A casserole dish? A friend's book or CD? These are wrong. It's wrong. Oh, it's just an oversight. No, it's not. You know you took it. You know you have it. They know you have it. but they're not going to hound you for it. But you still stole it. Maybe we all need to look around our homes, offices, garages, do an inventory. Have you ever noticed something and said, huh, oh yeah. I've had for quite some time now, probably the better part of a year, Kathy and I had planted a number of trees out here and went out and bought some trees and we put them there. And a nice couple in the church, you know, with a last name rhymes with Haley. And he came over and he offered this set of post diggers. But because of the type of ground and everything, it wasn't really conducive to using those. But they've been sitting in the shed over here since that time. And every time I go in that shed, I see them there. I said, oh, that's George's. I need to give that back to him. That's the kind of stuff I'm talking about. And so it happens. But you know what ends up happening? Some people will get to the point where they say, well, I'm not going to say anything now. And if we don't do that, you know, most of the things that we have, we don't really even need. Not only is it just from deprivation, but by deceit. By deceit. Proverbs 20 and verse 23 says, divers weights are an abomination unto the Lord, and a false balance is not good. Now you have to understand the former way of weighing things, you know, balance, you know. And so if you were supposed to put this and this side and that and that side, and that would balance out. But if you, you know, sometimes you talk about the butcher and he puts his finger on the scale, you know. Those are false balances when you do that. And so I think probably everyone has fallen into, we're all at the mercy of individuals who know more than we do about anything, right? You go to something wrong with your car. You take it to a garage and you have to rely on the honesty of the mechanic. I mean, if he said, well, you need a new Johnson rod. Well, oh, I didn't even know I had one of those. So, I mean, you're really at the mercy of them if you don't know, and that applies to just about everything. And there are plenty of people out there that'll take advantage of you. That's why for years they used to talk about salesmen, car salesmen that used to love to see women come in because they knew they didn't know anything about cars. That may not be the case today. P.T. Barnum said, there's a sucker born every minute. And someone else said, that may be true, but you don't have to take advantage of them. Many unscrupulous salespeople make exaggerated claims in order to take advantage of unsuspecting customers. It was driven just once a week to church by a little old lady. Some of you may not remember this, I do. Old Archie Bunker. He had a guy that came into his house and was trying to sell him and Edith a new furnace, and he was using a light meter, and he was going around, and he would go to the window, and as he went to the window, he would tell him that he was detecting heat loss, and so every time he would get near the window, it would go up into the red. Well, yeah, obviously. And so he threatened Archie that he was going to report him, and that they were going to come, and they were going to put a padlock on his basement. He wouldn't be able to use his furnace. This stuff goes on, people. The Bible said in Psalm 52 in verse 2-4, thy tongue deviseth mischiefs. Like a sharp razor working deceitfully, thou lovest evil more than good, and lying rather than to speak righteousness. Thou lovest all devouring words, O thou deceitful tongue. People take advantage of the elderly. That's a major crime going on today. You know why? Because older people are more trusting people. They grew up in a society where you looked at somebody eye to eye, you shook their hand, and that was the deal. And so when somebody says and they promise you something or whatever, they just take them at their word. We need your Social Security number. Just verify your bank account number for us, please. If you don't give us that information, you won't get your check this month. Next thing you know, they're rattling off everything. False advertising. I know you would never fall for that. Half the congregation is probably taking balance of nature. Forgive me, Lord. You know what you need to do? Always, all those advertisements, if you can, it's very difficult. You might have to pause it and go up close to the television screen and read the white, because it's the white little tiny print that goes, that this hasn't been verified, this hasn't been tested, all that stuff. I think it probably goes off the screen and says, and if you buy this, you're an idiot. But they'll do it. They'll send out these false claims. And there are plenty of people who will believe. It's like, what's that other one about sleeping? Yeah, Mike Huckabee. Relaxium or something? Is that the one? Yeah. It has no drugs. It has nothing. It has nothing about, other than the fact that they put nothing in a capsule, and you take one and you say, well I took something. How'd you sleep last? Well, I slept great. Why? It's all anecdotal. You believe that you took something, and so you did. And people will spend dearly. And see, that's why you have to charge a lot for it. Because if it was just a couple of bucks, you'd say, well, that can't work. But if you paid a lot for this, somehow it really works now. That's the other one, defrauding. Have you ever withheld something from someone who deserved it? You've probably watched Dateline or other evening things where a preacher defrauds his congregation out of $400,000. They say all kinds of goofy things. You know, the kind of, if you want God to bless you, you have to bless me. And you know what? I don't even fault the characters that do that stuff. And they just got a lot of nerve. The people I find ironic are the people that do it. I've never had the nerve to do it. Tell Chip. Chip, if only you could send me $100 a week, you know, God would bless you. And he'll bless you even more if you make it 200. But people do that stuff, and they continue to do it. All these stinking charlatans with their private jets that they fly around in and everything. It's like, go figure. The Bible says in Leviticus 19 and verse 13, thou shalt not defraud thy neighbor, neither rob him. The wages of him that is hired shall not abide with thee all night until the morning. Well, God had a way. I mean, we didn't wait a month to get paid. They didn't wait a week to get paid. If you work today, at the end of the day, you got paid. To not do that was considered defrauding. 1 Corinthians 7 and verse 5 said, defraud ye not one another. 1 Thessalonians, it goes on. God has to speak of it in the New Testament. He said in 1 Thessalonians 4 and verse 6, that no man go beyond and defraud his brother in any matter. In any matter. It could be something as simple as not giving someone credit for something well done. Now, some people won't do that because they say, oh, then he'll get a big head. He'll think he's special. Hey, it could be paying your bills on time. There's a kind of hush all over the world. Stalling the landlord's rent check. Oh, did I forget to sign that? When you run into someone's car in a parking lot and you don't leave your name. When you don't give your employer a full day's work for the full day's pay that you're going to get. See, again, acquiring stuff is okay. God says if you work diligently, if you make investments, if you obtain it by prayer. But covetousness is, and its resultant stealing is becoming extremely prevalent today. And it doesn't seem as though there are groups, organizations right now that are pressing, pretty sad, pressing the federal government to step in and do something. They say, well, it doesn't affect me. Well, it might. It might. It will ultimately affect you. I got news for you. All of these people, I know of a major box store whose position on thievery, shoplifting, is this. If they get 10 feet outside the door, they're gone. Let them go. How's that grab you? There are people that get fired in different companies for stopping someone, for confronting someone. We're creating this animal. And if we don't do something about it, you know what the problem with us is? Going back to about 1960, we threw God and the Bible out of the schools and out of government, and now we're starting to reap what we've sown. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever man soweth, that shall he also reap. You know, can't we just, remember, was it Rodney King? King. I was going to say Dangerfield. Yeah. He said, why can't we all get along? And people laughed at him. Remember Nancy Reagan? She said, just say no. Well, can I say something equally as ridiculous as those statements? Can't we just be honest?
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. May the message you've heard today speak to your heart, and remember, God loves you, Christ died for you, and ye must be born again. Thank you for watching.